Final talk of the final session of summer school. Yet another talk about elasticity, but this is the good one. just joking. So, Ioannis Konstantinos is a senior researcher with the Athena Research Center in Athens. And he will talk to us today about automatic application of elasticity in the clouds.
Thank you. So, I'm going to start with some very basics. So, this is the definition of cloud computing according to the National Institute of Standards and Technologies. And if you look at the same definition itself, it says cloud computing, set pool of configurable computing resources that can be rapidly provisioned and released. So keep this one, provision and release, with minimal management effort. And then following its description, it says at the end, rapid elasticity. Okay, so in the very essence of cloud computing lies the notion of elasticity. Okay, so what is elasticity? Can we say in a few words to a solid definition? So, I would say that elasticity is the degree to which a system is able to adapt to workload changes, okay, by provisioning the provisioning resources, okay, in an automatic way, so it can do it by itself, so that at each point of time, the available resources match the current demand as closely as possible. Okay, so if I have a system that can follow the demand and adapt its resources, then I win. Okay, I use the cloud as the cloud is as its definition. I mean, I do that. So, in a nutshell, allocation and deallocation of virtual resources, okay, according to an objective function. If we're gonna go one step further, when should I add new resources? How many? This is something that needs to be given by the user. So this can be a matter of cost, can be a matter of quality. I don't want to pay a lot. I want my answers to be fast. Okay, so this is this offers the true pay-as-you-go nature of cloud computing, because you say, okay, we have pay-as-you-go, but at the end, in order to have the true pay-as-you-go nature, you need your systems to be able to adapt themselves. So if they don't, then where is the true pay-as-you-go nature? You just rent five servers in Amazon and leave them there and you pay. This is not true pay-as-you-go. It's like buying, as we did 10 years ago, dedicated servers somewhere. Okay. Anyone can gain from this, both the provider and the user. The provider can optimally allocate, optimally use its resources to give it to more people. Okay. And the user, of course, wins by not using, by using only the amount of resources he requires. So this is a slide I have shown you 2 days ago. For those of you that didn't watch, this is a typical, let's say, motivation of our work towards elasticity. Okay. So in this diagram, we saw here how time progresses, and here how the, let's say, workload that is being applied on a system moves, changes during time. Okay, so let's imagine, let's say that this is a web farm of servers that serve cnn.com site. Okay, at some time there may be some peaks here. Something happened and more people went there to read. Okay. Now, as a system administrator, you can have this two strategies. You can over-provision here, meaning that I will have the maximum amount of resources always up, so that I will be able to provision for that worst moment, okay? Or you can make a static provisioning, but here you have an out at risk, because here, here, and here you won't be able to serve the knowledge. So, true elasticity for us is this: resources follow demand. That is what we want. Okay. This elasticity thing is being offered by, there are many, many companies, many startups that offer this kind of elasticity, okay. Most of the time it's very vendor specific, it's based on simple threshold rules, okay. So Amazon, for instance, has this auto-scaling functionality in which you only define a certain threshold and say if my CPU usage, aggregated CPU usage, is more than X percent, then add a new node or remove it. This is a we can do better than that, okay. And also, it is not a very, it's not very customizable. There are not a lot of ways to express what you want by as a user, okay. And it is simply, it's modeled as a single dimensional property. Many times it's just add nodes, remove nodes. There are other things that we can do on an infrastructure that are more fine grained. You can play with the number of cores, you can play with the size of the RAM, you can play with many things, okay. So the vision of the Sela project that wants to tackle this this issue is to develop methods and tools to apply multi-grain elastic resource provisioning in an automated manner. What do we mean by this? We want this to be to happen in a fully automated way. We want the system to leave it and by itself adapt to peaks and lows. Okay. We want it to be fine-grained, not strictly at the VM level. We want to be able to decide on the correct action according to what the user has said, and that action can be not simply add a new machine. It can be add another disk. I have a lot of write throughput, and this write throughput requires more I/O operations per second. Okay, get a new base volume, attach it, and do your work. When this ends, detach it. Okay. We need to be real time. We want this to be able to detect it quick. So this, and also to be standardized and open. Okay. So if we see this as a motivating example, we have the load, we have the throughput that is being produced by the load. So the this line is how the servers perceive the applied workload that comes from here. Okay. And if these are the size decisions, these need to follow very good the care, okay. And the actions that are being taken need to be taken fast. Okay. So the moment I realize that I want another, that I want to add a new resource, this needs to be first decided very quick and then enforced very quick. So otherwise, I'm losing. Okay. So this is the goal. So in order to do this, the seller's objectives come in four, let's say, four different levels. on the programming level, we want to be able to describe how an application is being for is being from what components this application consists of, how these components correlate with each other, how they communicate, so we can have a model or a graph of the entire application. And this is done on the programming level by the C++ tool. Okay. Another important thing during this automated elasticity is that you want to have an accurate picture of the current system state. This accurate picture is being given by the monitoring subsystem. The monitoring subsystem must be able to quickly and constantly evaluates the system's current state. And then on the platform level, we need also the central heart, let's say, of the system, a platform that can take the input from the user, from the C++ tool, and also the information of that of the current state, and be able to apply the rules to perform the elasticity actions, and be able this to take it on a real time using the decision module, and to also augment the middleware to support these elastic operations. Okay, and offer this bundled in a cloudification framework, so that the user can say can install it out of the box. This we want to achieve it very entirely, so we deploy it on over two different IaaS clouds. Okay, both clouds, the Oceanos open source cloud that is OpenStack compliant, so it is placed on Oceanos, placed in Amazon, placed everywhere. And FlexScale is FlexScale plug public platform, which is from the Flexient cloud provider company England. Okay. And we have two use cases on top of which we will be evaluating our system. The first application is an online gaming, which exactly has the properties I was showing you before, where you have unpredictable workload that you need to follow. Okay. And the other one is a scientific computing, in which you have a workflow of different systems that are being executed in order to extract information during a translational cancer detection pipeline. So you have one system that runs a lot of data, produces something else, etc., etc. Okay. So. This is currently what is being done in systems that run on top of cloud infrastructure. Okay, so here we have the physical layer. This is hidden, no one knows what's underneath Amazon. We don't know. We only know this. We have our virtual machines. Okay, we have our virtual storages, and we use this infrastructure. Okay, and on top of this infrastructure, we build. We install our systems, like the ones I showed you 2 days ago. Our NoSQL clusters, our processing frameworks, and all of this. And then we develop the applications on top of that. Okay. These services can be elastic. An edge-based NoSQL cluster, if you add more nodes, you get more throughput, you get more storage, you get more. The same with Hadoop, you add more nodes, then you run faster. Okay. But in order to do this, this is a highly manual process. You need to write your own scripts, you need to create your own set recipes, or Ansible scripts, or I don't know how to do it. Okay. And you also need to identify the time, when should I perform this action, or how can I orchestrate all these things so that they can operate. Okay. So, this seller offers these three boxes that are, let's somehow connect with the application, and in order to offer the functionality I told you. The one is the application management platform, that in essence describes what is your application employed. Okay, you have the cloud information and performance monitor that constantly evaluates what is going on your system according to user-defined metrics and whatever you want to measure. And you have the elasticity platform that does all the work. Elasticity platform has all the controllers, has all the logic inside, has the decision module, that this decision module, according to what the user has required, can takes decisions and performs them and make sure that everything works okay. Okay. In the heart of Seller, it's the elasticity platform that consists of a decision module, okay, which is an which takes automated elastic actions. These actions are being realized, are being enforced by a source provisioner module, which translates the abstract high-level actions into specific system commands and executes them. It's built on top of it uses Slipstream. Think of Slipstream as a chef or a puppet-like system. Okay. We also have a profiler, and the profiler, in essence, is being used to measure how the application or some modules of the application behave under a training workload that we apply before the running of the application, so that we can gather knowledge about how the application behaves. Okay. And this everything is being kept on Seller database, all this information, what's happened, how it happened. The heart of this work concerning the decision module that is being also published in CC Grid last year, 2013, it was awarded as a best paper. So, the application management platform has the tools, offers the tools to the user that wants to prepare the application, and its goal is to model the topology, to model any module of the application, what is its available elasticity actions, what can we do with that, what are the scripts that we want to run whenever we take an elasticity action. This is given there. Okay. The submission tool is used for the user to define his policy. So his policy may be, I want to not cross that much of, I don't want to run less than 2 milliseconds as a response time for my query, or I want to have a guaranteed throughput of that queries per second, okay? And this is offered through a Eclipse framework. So using Eclipse, you can model it, you can put your boxes and say this is a web server. The web server can be elastically scaled into this axis, etc., etc. The cloud information and performance monitoring is a monitoring system that is being used to constantly checks the performance metrics. Okay. With in mind to be able to be scalable overhead that can run on a lot of machines. In fact, the main contributor of the performance monitor is here with us, with Dimitris from UCY, that is working on that. And the interceptors work. This is very, very, very interesting. We require this kind of functionality because we want to also be able to measure, this is a very difficult thing that we are trying to solve, we want to measure in a bottleneck situation, for instance, where this bottleneck occurs. So for instance, I'm hitting a cluster of web servers and instantly I perceive that my throughput has gone down. Whose fault is it? Is it the fault of the front end? Is it the fault of the back end? How can I say that the database servers are not running fast? So the interceptor module, we want to be able to try and capture the latency or between the modules, and not this will give us more hints about how and what to do during elasticity.
Okay.
So during the first year, we have a working prototype which is you can download it from GitHub. Okay. The project has a strong scientific output with best paper award and research publications. We have the data going to associated with the project, so it's quite active, I think. Okay. This is some facts, and with that I conclude my presentation. Yes, in order to do that, there needs to be changes in the way the cloud provider offers this. So, there is this functionality called memory ballooning, in which you can expand the memory of a virtual machine while this is running. But then, this is something very experimental. In essence, what you can do is shut down the VM and restart it using giving it more RAM. That we can do. Now, this is the easiest thing to do. You can scale a VM on the RAM level by shutting it down and launching it as a larger instance, for instance. Yeah,
because actually, cloud provider, they don't provide this service scaling up or down based on the RAM usage, because you cannot control it. But the RAM usage can go up and down in an unpredictable way, so there is no way to handle it. Especially when you have multiple instances of multiple stuff. So that's why I'm asking this question. Another question related to the cost. Did you manage to build an implementation like scale up or down if the cost also exceeds a certain limit?
Yeah, it's a matter of policy. If the policy dictates that we can't have a cost, we can't exceed a certain threshold, then we don't launch more instances. So,
yeah, I would ask, are there any constraints or regulations in which we can use this system to improve the classification actually?
That's exactly the goal of the project, to be able to use it on any application. So as long as the application can gain from infrastructure, then it can be adapted to work on Cellar. And I'm saying this because not all applications can benefit from resources. I mean, if you have a MySQL cluster, a MySQL database, you can't just add another node. So in that case, comes a fine-grain elasticity. And what's fine-grain elasticity is give me more RAM.
or attach another disk, or add more CPUs. So if you think of all these possible actions as elasticity actions, then the whole canvas of the system can blow up extremely. So it's a very interesting thing to consider.
It's probably not like that you've had so far. How general is it? What kind of applications are you discussing?
Yeah, we are able to scale a couple of NoSQL clusters. I think it's Editase and Cassandra. We are also scaling web servers on an Apache web farm, and there's on the way Hadoop and
As far as I understand your approach, you're doing reactive staging, right? So you measure the performance, and then if the performance is bad, you scale up to more resources. So this means that for a certain time period, you have not enough resources to fulfill all the requests. So have you considered doing something like proactive scaling, you know, predicting the workload and then scaling before it happens?
Yeah. So this is an orthogonal approach. So you can do it. I mean, we are actually investigating forecasting techniques that can somehow predict, and this is orthogonal. You can use linear regression, you can use some typical statistical methods that forecast the workload, and taking into account how much time it will take you to perform the action, you can perform the action having in mind how the state will be after this has finished. So it is not currently in the system, but there are plans, and we are working to have this kind of forecasting.
Okay. Can I ask the last question?
Yeah.
So sometimes, probably everyone has experienced this situation where you have a large system, you know, everyone, you have this very large system, and nothing is running at capacity. Right? You look at CPUs, 50%. And then you look at I/O, not too high. And you just don't get the performance you expect. And what turns out to be the problem could be some contention, some log is being contended, some other issue. Is this taken into account by these systems where throwing the resource into the problem wouldn't help indeed in those cases, right? Because there's something else wrong with your system. It could be some software bug or concurrency issue and so forth.
It is true that sometimes throwing iron does not solve the problem. I mean, this is true. So in our case, the decision-making module uses this way of exploring different states. Whenever it makes a decision, it records back what was the gain of this decision. So if it takes a decision, adds more iron, and the problem isn't solved, then it won't redo the same fault. It somehow can adapt and learn by its mistakes. But if there is a bug, or if there are some contention issues and stuff like, or if, for instance, with something which is even trickier to find, there are contentions on the cloud provider's side, then you have a problem. I mean, you may be running at the same capacity and throw the same load and see different performance. So that is a true thing that needs.
Any other questions? Okay, let's thank the speaker. Yeah. So this concludes the summer school. Thanks everyone for attending, and special thanks to Yannis, thanks and Yorgos, who are the real engine behind the school. This whole thing wouldn't be possible without them. So special thanks to them.